By Renee's house?
Well, I don't know. That one too, but I wish that one in town.
Oh, does she?
We are live. Okay. Good afternoon. I'd like to call to order the North Bend City Council work session meeting for Monday, March 8th, 2021, 4:30 p.m. First thing on the agenda, looks like we have a couple presentations. And Mr. City Administrator is at the North Bend, Coos Bay North Bend Visitor and Convention Bureau semi-annual report. I see Janice is already online.
Absolutely.
Good afternoon, Mayor Engelke and City Council members. Very happy to be here today. I'm going to quickly share. Kaylee, can I get screen sharing opportunity?
It's $5.
But it's more impactful if I can share the presentation. All right, so this is our semi-annual report that we give to the city councils every year. And this particular one, you know, this has been a year. It's been an interesting year. It has been a year that was better than we anticipated. I'm gonna start with the budget. The far left column, or the second to last column, gives you the information of what we actually budgeted for this year. We went from a $1.19 million budget down to $765,000 because we had no clue. We didn't know what to expect from this past year. Thankfully, we have done significantly better than anticipated. First off, we started the year with a bigger carryover, mostly because we just stopped spending at the end of last year. So we ended up with an extra $145,000 in the carryover. However, we are also ahead of pace for both our lodging tax revenues and other income that we budgeted for. So as you can see, we are already at almost 95% of our budgeted income, but we've still, because this is only for the first two quarters of our fiscal year, are right on pace to spend the way we are meant to spend, which is at 50% of what we budgeted to spend. At the beginning of the fiscal year, when we did do this much lower budget, we had planned to scale down our advertising and marketing budget after 4 years of really steady growth. We are going to the Coos Bay North Bend Visitor and Convention Bureau Board of Directors this Thursday with a request to supplement the budget for our advertising and marketing, and using some of the monies that were in the carryover. So we want to make sure we stay on pace with our TLT and not use the excess that we anticipate we will have from all three funders this year, but we'll look to use the carryover extra of about $145,000 into a supplemental budget to add to our advertising. This is a reminder of where Coos County was in 2019. Visitors spent $277.3 million supporting 3,300 jobs. And this was in all sectors of tourism, but also all sectors of our community. So grocery stores and gas stations, as well as the traditional hotels, restaurants, and outfitters. Now, we know that this number will drop for 2020. We won't have those numbers until June timeframe, we believe. But because we are seeing the positive financial situation we are in right now, we are not anticipating that the numbers will drop as far as we feared. So this is just to give you a look at what happened at the pandemic, recession in 2009-2010. From 2010 to 2019, our growth in visitor spending went up 43%. So we can go down a little bit and still be in a very good position. And hopefully we will never hit that big of a drop again that we hit in 2009, which was, we lost 16% of our visitor spend in 1 year. So we know that we will have some drop, but we are not now anticipating as big of a drop. And I think the rest of the state, except for our big metro areas, are feeling the same. So I wanted to show you some of the recent advertising campaigns since the last time we spoke. Since we spoke last in October, we have had not holiday lights because we couldn't have that this year, but we did have an old-fashioned Christmas lights tour in our communities, and we did a lot of advertising for that with page takeovers in Medford, digital ads all over the state. We did a newsletter with 1859 magazine, and we even had several digital billboards out. Now, the campaign we're running right now is for our storm watching. So that was our 30-second spot that was airing on television stations in Eugene and Medford, as well as a pre-roll on YouTube. And it's been getting a lot of attention. In fact, the page that we set up for this special has gotten more views in the last 2 months than almost any other page on our website. So we're very happy about that. Part of our campaign for storm watching were billboards, both static and digital, that were out in Salem and Corvallis, as well as Eugene, Roseburg, Medford, and places in between. And then we also did a page takeover with the Mail Tribune in Medford, as well as digital campaigns all over the internet, an 1859 newsletter, as well as an e-blast from the Medford Tribune. We also did a couple of promotions, one in December, one in February. This is the promotion we did with, they're both with the Medford Tribune. For many years, they have done the 12 days of giveaways. Our prize was, the email that was specific for our prize went to 20,400 email recipients. We had entries at 1,480, and half of those opted to get our newsletter in the future. Now, this was a new promotion for them, the Sweetheart Sweepstakes in February. The email recipient list was slightly smaller at 17,600. We had 777 entries and 159 of those opted to receive our emails in the future. And we did a nice romantic package for that. Our next ad campaign is going to feature fishing, which is part of the reason we are going to the board to get a supplemental budget passed to use some of the excess funds that we have from the carryover, because the creating the assets for this campaign will take a little bit of funding, as we will be hiring a videographer as well as a photographer for this campaign. We have been really having a lot of writers visit us this year. The first three, Peggy Cleveland, Adam Sawyer, and Tracy Beard, all came out of a trade show I attended in October. I know it seems odd that I actually went to a trade show, but I went to a meet and greet with media that was put on by Northwest Travel and Life magazine. Peggy Cleveland and Adam have already visited. Tracy Beard is going to come sometime in May. She is a food writer, so we're trying to wait until Coos County is no longer in the extreme risk category. And Tim Neville, who writes for a lot of other publications, came to do a short story for Bend Magazine. And something new this year that we just unveiled, we now have an online store that sells the branded items that we have in the visitor center here in Coos Bay, as well as some over in the visitor center in North Bend when that facility is open. So folks can go onto our website and buy the crab masks, hats, t-shirts, hoodies, and lots of other items that we are selling. And then I want to talk real quickly about the gift card blitzes, the Operation Holiday gift card and the Operation Show the Love that we did in conjunction with the mayors of North Bend, Mayor Engelke and Mayor Benetti from Coos Bay. They brought an idea to a group of folks to help our restaurants. As you know, the restaurants have been disproportionately hurt during this pandemic with the opens and closures that they have had to go through, and now having to figure out how to do outside dining. So we pooled some money. We had funding from the Southwest Oregon Workforce Investment Board, the Wild Rivers Coast Alliance, both the City of Coos Bay and the City of North Bend, as well as the Travel Southern Oregon Coast Organization, with some in-kind assistance from KDOC Radio. We pooled about $32,000 in initial funding. We purchased 1,250 gift cards with this funding in December and did a one-day sales blitz and sold all 1,250 of those cards in 2.5 hours on a Friday at the Visitor Center in Coos Bay. Because we had all then the money that was left over from the initial funding plus the proceeds from the December card sales, we did the project again in the end of January with the intention of using all the money, not only the monies that were left over, but the proceeds that we would earn from the sale of these gift cards. And so we had 1,863 cards to sell. It took a little longer for us to sell these this in January because there wasn't a big holiday for which to gift these gift cards. But we did finally sell a majority of the cards. We ended up with a little under $1,000 in what was left in the fund, plus some donations that were picked up during the two Show the Love and holiday gift card programs, along with some donated gift cards. And Mayor Engelke, Mayor Bonetti, and I went to Operation Rebuild Hope and Brian's home just this afternoon and presented them with a check for $908 and I think it was 93 cents, plus about $300 in gift cards that they can use for the folks who end up living there at Brian's home. So we were very happy to be able to provide them with some support in that way. And now I'm happy to take any questions that you might have.
No questions? I don't think, no?
Good presentation.
Yeah, fantastic presentation.
Yes, very
Janice.
Nice.
I miss you.
Thank you very much. We couldn't do what we do without the support of our friends there in North Bend, the hotels there, but also the city council who allow us to do what we do. Councillor Garboden is on our board as the representative from North Bend, and we appreciate all of his time that he is able to give us and his support and insights as well. So thank you all again. It was a pleasure being here today.
Thank you. We appreciate you and all of your work. And I was just going to say, I miss having you come talk to my marketing students. So we'll have to bring you in via Zoom.
That would be awesome. Thank you, Jessica.
Okay. All right. Thank you. So moving on to our next item on the agenda, we have another presentation. I believe we were going to have Tara, correct, from the Devereaux Center with us tonight. There she is. Hi, Tara.
Hi.
All right, the floor is yours.
Greetings from beautiful downtown Dora. I raced homes because I have another meeting after this. So can I have control of the screen, or I'll just do my PowerPoint with me seeing it, and that'll be just as easy. And then I can email it to you guys and you can look at it.
I think we're in control of the screen here. You should have it.
Oh, okay. Perfect. Hold on. Now I've got. Okay. Sorry.
No problem.
Ways of technology. Okay. So most of you are at least aware of some of the Devereaux Center, but I'll give you a few highlights and then move into some more details that you may not be aware of. In 2016, we had 24 paid staff hours a week, which would be just over half of a full-time equivalent. And in 2020, we had increased to 240 paid staff hours a week, which is approximately five full-time equivalent. So we grew pretty exponentially during that four-year period. We have volunteers, about 30 volunteers each month. They are clients as well as community members. Currently, we have a couple of college students coming, which is great, and they're willing to jump in and do whatever we ask. Right now, they're both helping in the kitchen, where there's an unending amount of dishes to be done. But our volunteers help with cleaning, they sort donations, they do some light client support, kind of whatever needs to be done. We're usually willing to let people, you know, fit their skills with the needs that we have. So we serve breakfast and lunch on Monday, Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. And then we host the Waffle Project on Thursdays from 10 to noon. Previous to COVID, that was hosted inside the building. The Waffle Project very quickly switched to hosting waffles outdoors as waffle sandwiches instead of their traditional kind of buffet breakfast waffles. We have free laundry service. We offer hot showers. We have internet and computer availability for clients, phone calls, mail, a clothing closet. And pre-COVID-19, we had various support groups that were meeting. We have several requests that those be reinstated, but we're waiting until we get a little further into the vaccine program. We also offer identification replacement. We do require volunteer time. Unfortunately, the DMV and the state of Oregon don't seem to want to offer refunds. And I had at one point six different state ID or driver's license envelope sitting in my drawer, and that was just wasted money. So now that we require volunteer time, those IDs don't sit in my drawer. We do request that people have a very limited income or that they're homeless and that they're not eligible for other assistance. Sometimes there's other programs that will pay for their ID, and we do encourage that, because we're using just general operating funds at this point to cover those expenses. We offer transportation assistance to appointments, to court dates, DHS services, and in collaboration with Coos Bay PD, we help people return to their homes. In 2020, we helped more than 55 people return to their families or home communities, where they had comfortable connections with services. We also help with housing support, locating appropriate housing, completing applications. I had a bit of a wake-up call a while back when I actually helped someone complete their application for Section 8 housing. I was kind of shocked. I'm kind of a paperwork queen, and it was still rather challenging to know which things I needed to help them answer and which things we could skip. So we do a lot of that, helping people complete applications. And then sometimes we help people remain in their housing, whether that's negotiating with their landlord, helping them connect with other services. And then once we help someone get into housing, and this is where we differ from a lot of other organizations, even throughout the state, is that we help them stay in that housing through case management. We had a 3-year grant provided to us through Meyer Memorial Trust. That grant ended in December of this last year. We helped 40 individuals get into housing, and 31 of those, 75%, remain in the housing that we help them secure, which is an industry, that's through the roof in the industry world. We just don't see those kinds of numbers under normal circumstances. We operate People's Place, which is low-cost housing. We provide laundry, telephone, and television, and all their utilities. So pretty much they're responsible for food, and we'll even help them with toiletries through the Devereaux Center. The location has a large gathering area. It's in North Bend and convenient to bus stops. And it can be a stepping stone to independent housing if people choose that. The majority of the people who are there currently are totally comfortable staying there and would be happy to live the rest of their days there. It's not a requirement one way or the other. It's available to rent challenged individuals, often people who have had evictions or maybe have felony charges, things like that. We're willing to give them a second chance. And there's 11 boarding house style rooms. So individuals have their own room that they can lock, but then they share all of the common areas. Our future goals and plans are pretty ambitious. We want to add additional housing opportunities. And at the moment we're doing that through Azalea House and the community campground, as well as Ocean View Apartments. And I'll tell you more about that in a couple of minutes. We offer quality services. We want to increase our hours and add more days. That takes finances so that we can increase our staff. And we collaborate with our community. We have an excellent working relationship with Coos Bay PD, Oregon Coast Community Action, Coos Health and Wellness, Advanced Health, DHS, Bay Area First Step and Adapt, just to name a few. Pretty much anybody that provides services to someone who might be a client, we're going to be building a relationship with them so that we can advocate on behalf of our client when appropriate. The Azalea House is brand new. I mean, new to us. Brent and Melanie Beetham donated it to us at the end of the year. It's a mental health foster care facility. It'll have 5 residents, and it will be as much home-like as possible. We'll have a live-in manager, and people will be entered into the program through a referral by the county health department. It's in a convenient location to local clinics and the hospital. It will offer case management. Case management is key to the work that we are doing and to the needs of our clients. And community partner coordination, which is also huge. The community campground, which you may have heard about, recently was in the news through a decision that the Coos Bay City Council made to work with us on using a piece of land that's kind of near the DMV that will allow us to have a campground that is different than what Harmony United Methodist Church had in the sense that it will have 24-hour security. It'll be low barrier, and by that I mean not a lot of hard and fast rules. There will be rules, but not all of them, you know, set in stone. Sorry, I forgot to mute my phone. We'll have case management on site, so that clients don't have to move on, you know, go to find their case management. Again, community partner coordination. Clients will be allowed to stay for 3 to 6 months. And that's not a set in stone target, but rather if they're doing the things that they agree to do in their case management plan, then, you know, if somebody was a week or 2 weeks away from potentially getting into housing, we're not going to say, oh, you've been here 6 months, too bad, so sad. That's not what we're going to be doing. But if somebody refuses to meet with their case manager or even try, then they may be asked to leave sooner than 3 months. Referrals will be required for admission, and those referrals can come from any of our community partners, law enforcement, whether it's North Bend, Coos Bay, the county, tribal, you know, any of those would be able to make referrals, as well as other community partners, and of course the Devereaux Center. There won't be any after hours admissions. We really want to make sure that people go through the process correctly, and to have someone just, you know, dropped there after hours kind of creates a bit of an unmet expectation. The site will be clean and organized. I don't have pictures in this PowerPoint of what the site in Rogue River or in Medford look like, that's operated by Rogue Retreat, but it's clean. All the campsites are uniform. It's set up very well, and that's exactly what we want to do. And the site is located near a bus stop, allowing clients access to, you know, the various places they'll need to go in the community. And then this project, Ocean View Apartments, was unveiled, and I believe that Mayor Engelke was able to attend, as was City Manager Mill Iron. So Ocean View Apartments, it will be permanent supportive housing. And that's kind of a new term that maybe people don't understand. It means that with the apartment that you rent comes permanent support for the rest of the time that you live there. You'll have the opportunity for case management. You'll have assistance getting to medical appointments, even having someone help you remember those medical appointments. So it's in the planning stages with a 2 to 3 year timeline for completion. It will be focused on the tenant. So rather than an apartment that would normally have, here's your lease, have a nice life. It will be, you know, what are your needs? What can we do to meet the needs that you have and make sure that you can be successful? So in some cases that would be helping them come up with a budget or helping them get to and from medical appointments, things like that. We will currently target individuals who are currently unhoused. Long-term, there's no exit requirements. And we are pleased to collaborate with NeighborWorks Umpqua on this project. So these statistics are just from the Devereaux Center's database that we collect. 28% of our clients have some level of income, 17% sleep in a vehicle, 7.4% have a job, 38% are female, 50% of our clients are over the age of 50. That kind of dispels the, you know, 20-something who doesn't want to be responsible image that a lot of us have when we think of someone who's homeless. The average age is 44, and we anticipate or calculate that about 4%, maybe a little more than that, of our clients are under the age of 18. Now, we don't generally do an intake on super little children, so that number could be slightly higher. With mental health, that's a huge issue with most of our clients. However, surprisingly, only 12% admit that they have a mental health issue. We believe that number is closer to 90%. So we make referrals for counseling. We advocate. We help them get in touch with Coos Health and Wellness, stay in touch sometimes with Coos Health and Wellness. We support with making, keeping, and even attending medical appointments. And of course, assistance with other social services. 5% or more of our clients were in the foster care system, and 26% of our clients admit to being victims of abuse. Those are numbers that are really, really tragic. Those numbers create a trust issue with most of our clients. They're slow to trust anyone because of the trauma that's been caused in their past. We have about 13% of our clients are veterans. We make referrals to Brian's home. Thank you on the veterans' behalf for your generosity to the Visitors Bureau. We help with PTSD support, of course, food and clothing, and we work really hard to restore their self-esteem. It's very sad to see a veteran come in and having served our country be beaten down and discouraged and overwhelmed. The point in time count in 2019 revealed that 63% of the the point in time count individuals have lived in Coos County for longer than 1 year. Out of those 63%, 42% lived in Coos County longer than 10 years. 53% of those living in Coos County less than a year came here because they had family ties. 61% of those living in Coos County for less than a year drove to the area. 14% of those living in the area came via bus, but we don't know who purchased the bus ticket. I know that many times I've asked people, who bought your bus ticket? Oh, I paid for it myself. I wanted to leave the area, so I used my money and bought my own bus ticket. So these are some needs that we have. If people ask, we always need volunteers, various supplies, backpacks, tents, tarps, sleeping bags, small waisted jeans is a huge need. And then monthly financial support, $5 covers a week of showers for one person and $2 provides a meal. So those are all things that we need. That's it. So feel free to ask me questions.
Thank you, Tara. Thank you. I do have a question on the campground in Coos Bay out by the DMV. When do you think that will be set up, and how many spaces will you have?
So we are waiting to hear from a grant from the state, and they've told me that they anticipate releasing that on next week, the week of the 15th. So if we get the grant, then we're going to move forward as quickly as possible. The city is already working on getting bids for the work that they're contributing. And I'm working on figuring out staffing. So kind of taking a bit of a leap of faith that that the funding will be there. And then we'll move forward. So if the funding comes through, I would hope that we could be open by the end of April. We initially asked the city for 12 spaces, kind of in a good faith effort. But when I spoke with Roger last time, he indicated that he thinks there's room for 25. So obviously, if we could have 25 spaces right off the bat, that would be ideal, because it would lower the cost per person.
And is that on City of Coos Bay property?
It is on City of Coos Bay property, and in the end, we'll have a lease agreement with them.
Any other questions? Councilor Nordhoff has one.
Yes, do you have a website? Does Devereaux have a website, the Nancy Devereaux?
Yes.
And with
we
this,
do. It's thedevereauxcenter.org.
Okay.
I'll put it in the chat.
Okay. Will this presentation be posted on the website possibly for future reference?
That's an excellent question. I probably can figure out how to do that, but I can also email it to the city manager, and he can distribute it to you.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, a lot of data there. It's great.
I have another question. The Waffle Project, is that a national plan, or is that just something that you guys do? Is it basically brunch on Thursdays?
It's brunch on Thursdays, and Israel from Faith Lutheran in North Bend and a group of friends wanted to do something kind of to take people's mind off of their troubles, and went by the TV program that just left me that said, treat yourself. Anyway, that was kind of their inspiration. So it was a group of friends that initially started, and they wanted to do something nice, and it started out with just waffles with like homemade strawberry syrup, and then it kind of grew, and it was eggs, and they do like heart-shaped waffles for Valentine's Day and funfetti for, you know, the the 4th of July. So anyway.
Perfect.
Oh, Jane says that the TV show is Parks and Rec.
Yeah. Was there any other questions?
I had a quick one. Length of stay, do you have requirements for the other facilities at it, like People's Place or whatever? Because you mentioned Ocean View.
Ocean View would be permanent the rest of their life. Okay. People's Place is the same. People can stay there as long as they want. The Azalea House would strictly be based on the state, because it's in order to qualify for adult mental health care. It's a state level requirement because the state ultimately will be putting a large portion of their bill. So if the state decided that somebody doesn't need that level of support anymore, then the state would exit them from the program, but it wouldn't be us unless there were issues like behavior issues that were not able to be managed. And then the community campground, like I said, is 3 to 6 months. That's our target or our goal.
Okay. And one other question, a lot of good work in this set, but what's sort of the general set of your funding that helps support that?
So a lot of our funding comes from private donors. When I started 5 years ago, very little of our funding came from private donors and we were chasing grants, but we've kind of managed to make a shift there. We still do depend on grant funding. We don't have any funding currently from the state or federal government. If we get this grant, it'll be our first true independent state funding.
Good. Thank you.
Good luck. Okay, well, we appreciate everything that you do in the community and for speaking to us tonight. Mm-hmm. And we know how to get a hold of you if we have any further questions, I think.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next on the agenda, number 3, we have a discussion tonight, a July Jubilee. I believe our city administrator might have some comments to make here first.
So, Madam Mayor, as I introduced at the last meeting and asked you all to chew on this idea, is that here in Coos County, our COVID numbers unfortunately continue to climb. And so when folks start to ask whether or not we're going to have the Jubilee in July, it just doesn't seem responsible try to turn around and pull that off. However, as you look at some of the data and you look down the path to say August, September, October, and as more and more folks are vaccinated, and that we get past some of your winter flu-ridden months, that it would make sense that we potentially look at moving that festival to another date later in the year, sort of as a test pilot, but also knowing that it'll take a considerable amount of time to work with the health department and the health experts on making sure that we can have a sort of a COVID free event. At this juncture, if we were pushed, the recommendation from staff would be to go ahead and cancel the July Jubilee. But if it's the will of the council, we can look to network with some of our health partners and then try to work with other tourism agencies, other municipalities to figure out what other events are going and try to push that festival out later in the year. As I said, potentially maybe August, September, October, but the latter would be more inclined of the staff because you would be able to see where the virus was at that point in time. So I know it's the July Jubilee, but it's not going to happen in July. And so you really have to think about repurposing, and you either say cancel it or you tell staff okay, we're comfortable with trying to push something out to a later month, come back with a proposal and tell us what you can do.
I know I've been thinking about this, and the history of the July Jubilee is to celebrate North Bend and its birthday. But we could have a North Bend Jubilee. Doesn't necessarily have to be in July. And if the public health recommendations are to push things out a little bit further, instead of canceling something, I definitely would consider having a postponement of festivities and have a Jubilee of some sort in late summer or early fall. I don't know what the other counselors think about something like that.
I think we ought to have a celebration of some sort, but I'm used to postponing and moving things down and actually turning some things into virtual. So yeah, I do believe you'll have to push it a little bit later. And I always view time as our friend, you know, assuming things will come together and work out that way. The other side of it being too is we might, you know, look at and collectively, you know, talk about that individually, what type of thing we want to put together to do that. Now, over the years, of course, it started out, it was celebrating the birthday, and we had a cake, and we celebrated. Actually, it was a simulated cake to begin with, a big plywood thing on a float that went on that way. We did select our citizens of the years and so forth, and we had a parade of some sort, and we've had a variety of them. And a couple of years in, enthusiasm waned a little bit, and what we ended up doing then was you put together a string of vehicles and went all over town, you know, took it to all the areas in town to acknowledge here it's all part of North Bend and here we all are, and that worked out at that particular spot. I think that type of thing, you know, we could do. We've had a variety of activities, the latest being the 5K. We used to have a challenge softball game against Coos Bay and North Bend. We had a very interesting activity the Coos Head sponsored, which was the stud throw.
Yeah.
Which I thought was really, you know, it's sort of like the Scottish caber, whatever it is, where you run with the big thing. In this case, you're throwing a stud to see how far it could go that way.
Like a 2x4?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So
it was amazing.
2x4 javelin jump.
Yeah, and we had male and female categories and so forth. So, you know, we've done a lot of cute stuff going on, but it would seem to me we could come up with something to celebrate, you know, a North Bend Jubilee of some sort, which at this point, people want to be safe, but people want to see people too. So to me, it's an important part that we do something that makes sense at that particular time. And do it safely.
We're lucky to have on council here somebody from public health. I'm not sure if Councillor Gleason, don't turn around, wants to weigh in on that.
You're still on camera no matter where you face.
What are your thoughts on a potential late summer, early fall activity? And well, also, you know, I know that there's some other moving parts of things that happening. There's the county fair that's still up in the air. I think they're not making their decision until May.
I'd like to revisit that softball game.
Softball game
at some point. I think the Coos Bay North Bend versus.
That was fun.
I'd like to come back to that.
We had a lot of fun with that.
I'm all about that. It's not so much throwing wood. The numbers aren't good right now, right? So
right.
Pushing them out makes the most sense. And with the vaccine distribution models, if we could push towards late August, early September makes the most sense. Because as the Johnson & Johnson vaccine comes out, as the Moderna distributions continue to keep coming, once we get into the general population, it's really gonna be the healthcare system that's gonna be giving the vaccines out, not so much, you know, public health, which is a good place to be, because that means more people have had access to it, and the vast majority of people have been, who have wanted the vaccine, have been able to get to it. If we can get to that point where it's 16 and up can get their vaccine, then we're at a good point to say we could probably have some outdoor events. Obviously, we need to still maintain certain things, like CDC guidance that came out recently, or I guess it was today or yesterday, about if you've been fully vaccinated, you could take your mask off with your friend, your family, right? Like someone, you could have your grandparents over and you could take your mask off because you've been fully vaccinated. They even said that you could hug each other. I still don't recommend that. But as we get more people vaccinated in Coos County, we're more likely to be able to have these things. And that's something that everybody's going to want. I would absolutely say if we could push it to late August, early September, we would be in a place where we could actually be together again in some capacity. Maybe we still have to wear masks. Maybe we still have to do some sort of preventative measures, because I think that's going to be something that doesn't necessarily go away, especially with Oregon having its very own variant now. But I think it's a place that we could get to. Okay. I really do.
And I, yeah, Councilor Ball?
I just want to comment that September is traditionally a pretty busy month in other places. I think it's the, in a normal year, it would be like the Blackberry Festival and the Fun Festival. So if we could, if Eric's crystal ball is right, you know, the end of August might be more of a target, in my opinion. But,
or even Oktoberfest. October is beautiful here.
Get some beer steins.
No, let's keep the good weather, which would be August, September.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think late August probably is the best target to shoot for at this point.
Yeah. So the staff would be looking for some kind of a consensus from us, and this does fit in with our strategic plan and our goals that we talked about, is looking at trying some new things. So this would give us an opportunity to try some new things this year. So you're looking for a consensus from us to kind of come back with a potential proposal of something, and you know, checking the other city dates. I feel like the Blackberry Festival is around August 18th, but I can't remember. Is it? It's the 28th. Okay, so I'm sure we.
Are they going forward with it, or is?
Well, that'll be all the moving parts of who's doing what, and
yeah, we don't know yet.
Yeah, there's so much up in the air.
Yeah. So for our point, you know, if there's a consensus that, you know, no July Jubilee, but look at coming back to us with a proposal, and. Quite frankly, I would like to try to entertain as much public participation in that, and try to solicit as much ideas as we can. And we can do that online. We have the capability of doing that, and sort of getting a feedback where we can sort of, you know, see what is it the public would like, and try to incorporate that in our proposal back to the council. And then get a planning committee going. Hopefully each council member could, you know, pick someone to be on a planning committee and help further that new reinvented event of a jubilee, whatever that might look like.
Right, right. Yeah. So therefore it's not necessarily canceled, it could be just a jubilee postponed.
So I have one question. What about the court,
the princesses, that would be up to that committee, I guess, of what they would do.
I think you can go ahead and still have
them. Yeah.
Because the reason I say that is because we sponsored the Cranberry Court last year, and they didn't have a festival, but they did do the court, and had the princesses and stuff and everything, and so I mean it did happen, you know.
Well, I think that
it wasn't
makes
the
sense.
Same, but they, you know, but you know, like you said, it's just gone on.
Well,
and they get their pictures every year at City Hall, and that, I think.
And
that
look
part,
what happens to Jubilee princesses.
Right.
I mean.
Yeah. Look.
You know, 30 right. years later, you could be mayor.
It could happen.
I'd like to see it continue, but I'm obviously biased.
Okay.
Well, I think it should happen.
I think that those princesses play a key role in the whole process ultimately going on to other competitions, and so
and you can actually do that in July.
Exactly, and so there are things that can continue. I mean, I know the current, I think they sort of got a 1 year hall pass, so they actually had some double duty, but there are things that can still take in place, you know, that's some of the coordinating efforts. So by all means, We don't want to throw all traditions out. That's not our goal here. Our goal is to try to find a COVID-compliant way to sort of reinvent the Jubilee and probably drop the four letters July and sort of do it in a safe manner.
And that doesn't mean that we can't have cake in July for North Bend's birthday. We can still also have some sort of birthday celebration because I am a fan of cake as well. Yeah.
I wonder if that float still exists.
You could hand out cupcakes.
Does it? The cake float? Yeah,
we could hand out cupcakes.
Wow.
So
they can get their own. Don't
you have enough information from us?
You actually get hostess ones that are self-sealed.
Moving that forward.
Yeah, mm-hmm. We'll start working on that and come back to the council. And like I said, you may start to see some citizen engagement opportunities where we start collecting some data and trying to, you know, get some input from the public. What would they like to say?
I think that we need some citizen input to revitalize the Jubilee because it's become stagnant over the last few years.
Yeah. Okay.
To a certain extent.
And council are citizens too, so if you get a wild idea, put it in the pot.
Yeah. Councilor Nordhoff is raising her hand.
I knew the people in last year's band, and I didn't go because I was on the history tour of, you know, made it to all the places on the east end of the county. But I thought that was fabulous, a fabulous idea. And I understand it was well received.
Was that a band during?
It was a band right here at Grant Circle, from what I understand, on the July Jubilee Day.
Oh, I don't.
Which I thought that was pretty neat. And that drummer, he landed in the Bay Area concert band, and we were leaderless. We didn't have a section leader. And after one concert, I nailed him. I asked him to be our section leader with the approval of band council. He's excellent. So it was just fortuitous. It all fell into place, and he was their drummer. So
cool.
All right.
Yeah, really good find.
Lots of things to look into then. Okay, so moving on in the agenda, number four is to review the March 9th City Council agenda. So you have your packet before you. We have the first thing on the agenda tomorrow night, call to order. Then we have some ceremonial business, and it's the retirement of, is it Stephen or Stephen?
Stephen.
It is Stephen Perry. Did the city administrator or the police chief want to talk about that a little bit at all?
The chief, I think, will make a presentation tomorrow. This is one of the reserve officers, if I'm not mistaken.
No, he's just a police volunteer. He did a lot of our parking enforcement, handicap enforcement, abandoned vehicles. He was extremely helpful. It is sort of a day-by-day process with him because of some health conditions, so I'll be calling him tomorrow to see how he's feeling.
Okay.
And if he's doing all right, we'll do it. If not,
okay, so we won't make any then special plans now to take a photo, but if the opportunity tomorrow, if during the presentation want to come up, take a photo at least with you and him in the plaque.
Sure.
Not going well. Okay. All right.
Yeah, I think if the chief gets positive confirmation, I can alert you in advance.
Come a few minutes early or something.
Yeah, we could come up a couple minutes before the meeting, take a photo with the.
Okay. And the third item, we've got the consent calendar. Was there anything specific on here that you wanted to go over?
These are the minutes. So this is an opportunity if there's any issues with your February 9th or February 23rd minutes to let us know. We'll make corrections. Otherwise, it'd be on the consent calendar for tomorrow.
There's Engelkey was spelled wrong.
Oh.
On a couple of
L's.
Like every other time it was an extra L in there or something. Okay.
Hey, we don't have any bills.
And that's the bills great. Aren't in this packet, correct?
No, we, as we had chatted at the last meeting, so we're switching to a more procedural process. So our finance director is here and can remind you all what we're doing so that we're all on the same page.
So you've already received copies of the bills that were paid for February. So what we'll do is in April we'll bring you a listing. Those were presented during February.
each month after the bills are paid, then we'll have a list from them.
You'll get one listing at the first meeting of the month.
Okay, does that make sense, everyone?
And then that way online, we'll be posting a check registry for everything that was paid.
Got it.
Which keeps us in line with, obviously, anything that exceeds the spending authority automatically goes before council.
Mm-hmm.
So these are your standard procedural, you know, bill pay, if you will. And so when we reviewed the charter and ordinances, this has just always been because it's been, but it's not, you've already approved a budget, so it's an authorization to spend. So unless it's outside our authority, and in order to make sure that we keep the bills paid without any late fees, we're just going to do it as a one swoop transparency and then put it before the council.
Okay. Then we'll have public comment on the agenda, and then number five is the there'll be a resolution 3300 for intergovernmental agreement with Coos Health and Wellness, a Department of Coos County Parkside Motel abatement. This is in page 14 of the packet.
I would imagine I would then recuse myself from that conversation as well.
Okay.
Yeah, so on page 15, Madam Mayor and Council, you have the basic resolution, and then it's followed by the intergovernmental agreement. The intergovernmental agreement has been shared back and forth with the county attorney and then our city attorney. The county has already signed their version, and then once approved by this council authorization, then I would sign and execute the agreement. The finance director is working with the hotel to audit their hotel transient tourism tax so that we can present a bill so that they can close, I believe, within the next 30 days.
Okay. All right. Any questions about that line item here? Six is the resolution 3301 intergovernmental agreement with, so this is the community block grant. An Oregon Coast Community Action for rental assistance, correct?
Yes, Madam Mayor. Previously, in chatting with the council, we had made indication that the city, in cooperation with the county, would be entering into an agreement to go out after $600,000 in rental assistance. It would be available countywide. In order to do so, we have to have an agreement in place. This particular agreement is Coos County and Orca. Orca will be coming with a secondary agreement, but this simple agreement is between the city and the county, acknowledging that Orca will be a strategic partner. The service agreement that will be coming from Orca, it's not done yet, so it's not on this packet, but will be coming. They will be the grant writer, and then if approved, they will be the grant administrator. So they actually will be working with the individuals and making sure that they qualify for the rental assistance, and then actually dispersing those funds in partnership with the city.
So what is the city's role?
City is actually the applicant for the federal funds. And we can't go on our own. We have to partner with another government. So because there's already two other CDBG grants in play, Coos Bay is working with Reed Sport on a rehabilitation housing project. The county already is working with its microenterprise business CDBG grant program. So then the city is going to utilize the county, so you do the partnership with another government so that we can actually apply for the federal funds. So our physical responsibility will be, we're responsible for the audit if we exceed $750,000 in federal funds in a given year. And then it's our legal cost of going through these agreements and getting them before the council. So, and then we actually have staff time working with Orca on generating the material for the grant application. From that point, once we're awarded, if we are awarded, the administration then hands off to ORCA to administer the grant. There is going to be, I believe, four phases of this particular grant. I'm not so sure timing that we're going to get on phase one, but we very well will be in phase two. And then if we're able to spend all $600,000 of relief in phase two, we'd be eligible for phase three and phase four, also a subsequent $600,000. So this is helping our residents who are either have been really disenfranchised by COVID, unemployment, work, inability to make payment. And so they have to go through a criteria. They have income threshold minimum for which they have to meet to qualify. And then the landlord has paid the money. That actually doesn't go to the tenant, it goes to the landlord. Yeah. And they are a business. So this is actually helping those individuals that rent property individually or as a business.
And then usually on something like this, with the cost of facilitating the grant that ORCA would incur would be paid by the grant, right?
Yes, their administrative cost is actually coming out of the grant.
Yeah.
And then working with our finance director, we have taken our estimated cost and we'll be putting it forth for consideration for reimbursement as part of the federal grant dollar process.
Yeah.
And so far as that agreement, there's no expiration on it?
The expiration on this actually sets on the thresholds of cycle 1, 2, 3, and 4 from the state.
Okay.
So as long as the program's open, we can apply, and then we can come back to the council and get authority to apply again and again and again.
Okay. Thank you.
We had a requirement to partnering with someone that has rental assistance experience, mm-hmm. and that's what ORCA brings to the table.
Sounds like it could be really helpful to our citizens. Okay, let's see here. We've got number 7 on the agenda is National League of Cities Service Line Warranty Program by HomeServe, page 21 of our packets.
Ralph, you want to come on out front center, please? I know you love sitting up here. But.
Right and loud, right into the microphone. Put the spotlight on you.
I'm sure you could have heard me from back across the room.
Hey, no.
However, we took this before council about a year and a half ago. Mm-hmm. It was fairly new in the area. Coos Bay just did this. And Home Service partnered with the National League of Cities. Basically, what they asked the city to do is use our logo on the promotional. We, Reedsport at the time, Reedsport and Coos Bay, put this together and we're just starting it and we wanted to see how it worked out. I have been contacted by Roto-Rooter and Econo-Rooter saying, why don't we do this? This, it seems to have worked out well, at least from a contractor standpoint. Smooth, people get paid. They're looking at often a $3,000 to $7,000 sewer lateral repair, mainly is what Roto-Rooter's talked about. And the economy of scale, if you look at Exhibit A, it's an insurance policy. They use us as a promo. It's an insurance policy. If we bought the whole package, you're about $25 a month.
It's a subscription service, correct?
Correct. You can cancel at any time. And honestly, if you have an older home, it's probably worth your money.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, I think one of the last, when this came to us last time, Ralph, I think one of the biggest questions that we couldn't get answered was they were trying to promise within like 24 hours or something that they would have a licensed contractor on site or something. And it sounds like to me that if Roto-Rooter and Econo-Rooter and whoever else is involved is asking us why we're not a part of it, obviously.
They're making money at it, but it benefits the homeowner significantly because instead of a, like I said, $4,000 to $7,000 bill.
Probably assures Roto-Rooter they're gonna get paid.
Right, well that too, but I'm just saying because that was one of the questions that we were asking is like, who's going to perform the work in this area?
Right. They didn't have any contractors. Have the yeah. They did not have contractors a year and a half ago.
Correct, and I think that's why we kind of stalled around on that thing. It sounds like that's been taken care of at this point.
Yeah, and they don't, they only take care of it, it's still like in any other insurance. They don't replace your whole lateral if only a third of it's broken.
Mm-hmm.
And talking to Robert Rampless, that's the only thing he really has to explain to the homeowner. You have it, we'll give you a price, it's covered, but I can't repaint your whole car because you have one dent.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Basically, like any other insurance.
Right.
Councilor Nordoff, did you have a question?
Yeah, would they? I replaced my sewer lateral a couple summers ago, and I got a quote from, I think it was Roto-Rooter, and they were quoting to do a HDD installation, horizontal directional drill instead of open trench, which is what I did, and the difference was substantial. I think it ended up costing me like $1,500 for the plumber fee, but I dug the trench out myself, so I'm wondering are they going to go with the more expensive repair because there's insurance, rather than, you know, dig it up with an excavator?
They're going with their certified contractors and whatever they recommend. The insurance company is just like your auto insurance, whether you want to go to Burgers or you want to go to Paul Trim to have your car painted. You have the choice.
Mm-hmm.
They have a limit on approximate value, you know, but we won't pay for GM certified parts.
I think it was like $8,500 that they said they were up to cover on that. On that.
But so that's not really in the city's use on this, and it did create a little bit of stir in Coos Bay because they didn't know, people didn't understand because there's our logo on the letterhead.
Mm-hmm.
Those initial letters came out and they said, was the city asking us to buy insurance? It really isn't. And in Coos Bay, it was worth more money because you have to replace your lateral all the way to the main. In North Bend, we fix in the street. In Coos Bay, it's all the way to the main. But really, the city's involvement, and we can get 50 cents a policy if we want, or we can decline it. That's up to our decision. It would not produce, I think they have 500 policies, almost 500 policies in Coos Bay.
Okay.
That's $250 a month.
Yeah, it's
not big money, whether we want it or don't want it.
That's a good deal for the homeowner, so potentially.
And all we're doing is blessing it.
Yeah. All we're basically doing is blessing it and are using our logo as a promo. So we'll get some calls.
Okay.
What is this?
Okay.
Beyond that, it's private insurance.
So the homeowner will be able to decide if they want to purchase it.
Yeah, that's subscription
okay.
service. Yeah, you don't have
okay.
to have it if you don't
Absolutely.
Want it.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. Oh,
okay.
A little tiny headache when it first comes out because people are saying, what's the city trying to sell them? Beyond that, it's a real advantage if you have an older sewer system and need to fix it.
And may I?
Mm-hmm.
Now, at least in Portland, it's considered pretty standard that they put a camera down the sewer line and look at it during the before a house sells. So it's something that the prospective buyer is requiring as a checkout to check out the integrity of the sewer. And my friend up there had to replace her sewer lateral on her property before it sold.
Okay.
So anyway. Looks good.
Thank you.
And we already provide that service for free. So.
Right. I've used it. It's a huge, it's a great service.
So don't go anywhere because it looks like it's the Ralph Show for number 8, 9, and 10. Next item is the contingent award of bids for Broadway Avenue Sanctuary or Sanitary Sewer Replacement, correct?
Correct. And unfortunately, ODOT did overlay, grind and inlay a portion of this regular replacement sewer, but we had miscommunication. However, we received 4 bids. They were all underneath the engineer's estimate. Benny Hempstead Excavating was the low apparent bidder, so we will be recommending, or staff recommended, that we award the project to Benny, Caney's Excavating, sorry. Benny sold out. He's actually retired, so.
And it is going to go down the new
the new three.
We're right alongside it. What we'll end up, when it's all said and done, we're actually gonna grind and inlay the interior lane, so the second lane from the curb.
Mm-hmm.
And repave all that. Because to be honest with you, the cost of doing that is not much more than just paving a trench. You pay, don't want to get into the economics of it, but you pay about $180, $200 a ton for asphalt. Mm-hmm. If it's less than 10 feet in width, if it's over 10 feet in width, you pay $130 a ton for asphalt, so you can actually go wider
and not
pay cheaper. Or not. It doesn't pay cheaper, but that extra 4 feet or something to do a whole lane costs you pennies on the dollar as opposed to just paving the trench. So, needless to say, we're starting about 290 feet out of Virginia. We didn't want to get, and we'll end up coming to you later this year. We're going to cast in place pipe and situ line all the way into Virginia. But I didn't want to have that intersection tore up, so we're dropping a new manhole so we can line that pipe into Virginia from the intersection. So we're starting 290 feet out to 12th Street, and you'll end up with two lanes paved instead of one lane paved.
What's the diameter of that?
10 inch. And we're doing laterals all the way across the street, which is a tricky part. So we'll be out of the road for 50 years. That's our intent.
Yay.
For the low, low price of $370,600.
Okay.
Bargain.
Number nine is the authorization for providing professional service pump, station number 5.
In 2018, we have come to you before talking about doing the pumps right in pump station 5, because we're replacing $70,000 worth of pump in 9 years. There are some issues with the pump station that have been there. I designed it in 1985, so you can blame me. I originally designed pump station 5 and installed it, but the first pumps lasted 20 years, so. Regardless, we contacted the Dyer Partnership. Bob Dillard had already had them do some preliminary work on it, and they provided us a proposal for professional services. And to be honest with you, if we want to get our paving projects done this summer, I don't have the time. I can do this myself, but I don't have the time to do this along with our other projects. So staff is recommending we contract with the Dyer Partnership to do the design, specify the new pumps, do some research, and get the right pumps. We're dealing with about $100,000 worth of pumps here, and potentially part of the header and everything else adjusted to make things last a little longer. I don't think we'll spend all of the $47,000.
Not to exceed 40.
It's okay. A not to exceed number.
Okay. Okay. Any questions about the pump? All right, and then the last one that you have is the grade ordinance 33, established grade of Connecticut Avenue.
This is a simple process. Council approved the opening of Connecticut Street to serve the new development there in Coos Bay on the airport in Section 8. Council is required to establish the grade of the street. The primary reason for the grade of the street or the grade ordinance, besides establishing where the street is so that the utilities go in. The city doesn't put in a road and then the utilities go in and then we dig it up later because nobody thought about what grade that street was supposed to be at. So the real primary reason for it is so everything goes in there and knows what it's going to be built to and everybody's happy and we're not tearing something up and adjusting things later.
That's the one that's going to run into Coos Bay, is that
right?
Correct?
Right, where Maxwell Lane.
Right, right.
The old trap ranch.
Right. And it's going to be how many lots?
13.
13 new lots. Yeah. So we're helping out our sister city.
That's right.
Correct.
Build those houses and then.
I have other business, but we'll go to the rest of it.
You'll have other business tomorrow night.
Hang tough. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
So 11 is the city administrator's report, 12 is committee reports, 13 is council comments, 14 is other business. Ralph, you're back up.
You're back.
So I'm going to hand this out, and I will tell you while I'm handing this out what prompted this. Part of it's a TSP
the Oregon Coast Bike Route, we've been trying to figure out how to get some bike routes through the city and have less hassle.
Go find my house.
The bicyclists. So I've actually been arguing with ODOT a little bit. They wanted to come down Union. Union's narrow, and we have an existing trail system through partially improved through Simpson Park. So what you see on this aerial photo, which I did some quick sketching on, is basically a paved trail through Simpson Park, bike lane striping down two blocks of McPherson, or excuse me, Mead, which is 50 feet wide. So it has lots of room, and the pavement's in reasonably, Susanna may say it different, but the pavement's in reasonable condition. Mm-hmm,
true.
Then going down Montana, down to Hamilton, which is also 50 feet wide, so there's lots of room to put a bike path. And finally, on the gravel portion of Hamilton, and that will probably be a separate phase, developing a bike path there out to Virginia. Now, there's a couple reasons for this. One-on-one, as everybody knows, if you're walking or biking on it, plus with our new improvements on the bump outs, is a little tough for a bicycle, a little more stress. Also, you may not be aware of it, but Virginia actually is narrower, actually widens between Monroe and Harrison. It's the street pavement is actually, I think, 8 feet less wide going from 101 to Monroe, and then it widens out at Harrison. So there's a little more room for a bicycle to travel. Beyond that, Brian has had some issues with illegal camping in the park. Mm-hmm. And if we open up, we're looking at opening up a 10-foot wide paved trail. The main reason for 10 feet in width is we can service it with a vehicle. We can drive a vehicle down the path. Bike lanes are typically 6 to 8 feet in width. Plus allows for pedestrians and bicycles to do this. And there is funding available to do this. I've included in your packet, there's a grant application through Travel Oregon that we think we have a really good chance at. It's up to $100,000. The application period is March 15th through March 31st. I just
No matching.
Up to zero matching. Which we have actually established some funds
to
strike.
That's good.
Yeah, up to zero matching.
Zero to
and
good
And I also included, because I think we'll phase this, if this is council's, the recreational trails program, which is what Coos County has been using on Winchester Trails to do. They've received over $300,000, and that is a 25% match.
Right.
So basically the other business portion of this is looking at city council to authorize staff to apply for the grant. We would probably have to, we'll get a signature at our next meeting because the first one, the Travel Oregon one. In my estimate to do just a trail through Simpson Park, which is roughly 1,200 feet, is $83,000. And that would include new garbage cans, some bollards, some signage.
Isn't that a pretty good grade drop, though?
That dropping down, that's the reason you see this little swirl there coming down to Colorado.
I grew up right there. I know exactly where that,
it's actually, with the grant criteria, we might have to jag a path out next to the, run a path out to McPherson. Because to meet ADA requirements, I don't think we pad on coming down that hill. I'm looking at 14 to 16% grade. ADA requirements 8% maximum. So I don't think without completely wiping out the park that I can get down that hill.
There's the bluff trail that was put in by an Eagle Scout a couple years ago. That starts out from Mead and goes swings west and goes right along the bluff. And then there's a trail that follows the north end of McPherson past the tennis courts and drops down some stairs into right in front of where the basketball court is in Simpson Park, that and the new playground. I think that if the idea is to kind of make that part of the park less hospitable to homeless camping, I think it'd be good to stay with this layout and whatever, you know, kind of run it through the middle, up the grade, and trying to see where it really takes off. It takes off from the flats where the playground is and goes around the tennis court or the basketball court, and that's a pretty gradual climb up to the top of the bluff, and then it kind of
drops back down.
It's, if you go by the tennis court, right, that's a pretty steep right. grade.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about.
But
yeah,
if you go up the middle, then it's fairly gradual as far as I'm aware. It's yeah, thick with blackberry. There's, so that would be an improvement right there.
We're looking at if we proceed with this and getting a piece of equipment to clean the underbrush out. And we're not looking at cutting any big trees or anything. The only place I see potentially having problems with trees is getting down that grade down to meet. We'll say bigger trees. There might be some 3-4 inch trees in there, but that's the only place I see. I know it's maybe an issue, but that's the only place that I see any real issues with not being, because we can route a path snake around through the trees. It's just mm-hmm. coming off that grade is going to be a little bit more of an issue than.
Well, I think you guys are all on the same page. I mean, the more we can clean that up, the better off Chief's going to be, everybody's going to be. So,
they've cleaned up 4 camps in the last 2 weeks in there.
I just had a couple more. Just this past week, and then that first set that I posted, gosh, that's been 6 weeks. So we've consistently have had more and more camps. We're removing them pretty much as quickly as they're resurfacing.
So tomorrow you'd be looking for authorization to apply for the grant. When you apply for the grant, is this set in stone? Like, you'll come back with
the exact location of the path. We'll have to do some work. The Travel Oregon grant has to be done by November 30th.
So we have to apply. Our window to apply is March 15th to March 30th.
Okay.
And then we have until November to complete the project.
Wow.
So as Ralph says, this is aggressive, but this actually was just announced, so this is very quick, easy, found money.
Yeah, this mm-hmm. is great.
And there's a high probability that we'll get it. So I will tell you that I've already, regardless of the council, I've already authorized working with Ralph and Park to go ahead and get the equipment, reclaim the space that we already have had as trail that's overgrown. Mm-hmm. So regardless, we're starting that process. That's about a $4,000 process. And then so the council would have to authorize us, because it's going to be a 2-week very narrow window. We have to get in there starting on the 15th, which is Monday, mm-hmm. get the entire application and all the documents required, financial documents, and get submitted by the end of the month, and then we wait.
Well, it looks like it would be a really good bike route and pedestrian trail, maybe some potential runners and walkers.
Absolutely. It'd be a multiple use trail. It just so happens that because it facilitates Oregon Coast bike route also,
mm-hmm.
it probably ups our chance of getting funds.
Yeah, I like it.
So Ralph, do I recall that there was like some money set aside a long time ago where they were going to like do the trail through Pony Creek and all that? Is that different from this?
We get about $7,000 a year, not real money, for footpaths and bike trails.
Right.
And the city had saved that up forever, plus got a grant. And part of this is the Sawmill Trail. There is some historic trails, and there was one going all the way up to Newmark.
Right, that was the one that they were talking about building.
We spent almost all our money on the consultant study.
Yeah.
And the design included wood boardwalks across Upper Pony Creek, the wetlands from the school district in Newmark, or from the middle school, which would have been maintenance. That would have been a gift that kept on giving forever. Unfortunately, we still have that plan, but.
I just didn't know if there was any money.
There's no money.
Okay.
Although, this actually follows part of that path, although they actually were coming right along the.
Yeah, down on the waterfront there.
Down along the waterfront, and with the wetlands rules and everything else, and producing boardwalks and that type of thing to maintain.
Okay.
Yeah.
Personally, I think that's sort of good money after bad, or bad money after good, or whatever you wanna call it.
That was all I had. I just didn't know if there's still any money in there for that.
There is money available. I mean, Travel Oregon, and there's money to do the trails. I always think about the cost once. We built it, now we gotta maintain it.
Yeah.
That's fine.
And that, you're gonna figure signage all the way out to Virginia, right?
Correct.
Okay.
The first phase, what the Travel Oregon grant, I'm looking basically to get through.
Yeah.
Simpson Park, and potentially stretch it to pay for bike lane striping. By the way, we're paving Montana this summer also, so nice new pavement to put nice new bike striping on. We can show that as match. I'm looking at probably phase two if we go to the trails grant, more to deal with Hamilton.
Excellent. All right, thank you. So that would conclude what our council packet is for tomorrow night. Tonight before you guys have a couple comments, so some public comment that was submitted to the council, but none to be spoken at. Nobody's online for any further comment. Was there any other business or any other thing that we wanted to for tomorrow night, or an executive session, councilor, city administrator?
Not that I'm aware of. We will potentially know tomorrow morning if there's something executive session. But at this point, no. The trail grant will add, because there's no cost to the taxpayers.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be adding that to the agenda. We're doing so by giving notice today. That'll be on the agenda. That's simply just an authorization to apply. So you're not, you're in compliance with your open meetings laws.
Okay. All right.
We do have $21,000 budgeted for striking bike paths.
Okay.
For this year already, so.
Okay. Councilman Nordhoff, did you have a question?
I have a question. I thought that I heard that now the new Parks Committee is closed to anybody who's not appointed to that committee. Is that, did I hear right, or did I hear wrong on that?
Your committee chair is shaking his head over there.
That is the, I believe, how it's set up now.
Why is that? Because I saw in the council rules that any council committees, all of them have to abide by the open meetings law. So I guess I'm asking for justification.
I'm not sure.
Can I ask really quickly, Susanna, what part of the open meetings law do you feel that violates?
Having people, and I don't have it in front of me, but I looked through the sections, and it's like, I think it's 162 through 172, and I looked through it, and I believe that it says that people in our citizenry should be able to come to a Parks Board meeting, and I don't see any reason, I didn't see any justification in the council rules at all for saying it's that those meetings are closed off to the public. I mean, public parks are a huge part of the city infrastructure. So I guess I'm looking for the justification of saying that it's closed now to our rank and file citizens to give input on what's happening with the end decisions that are made at the city parks. I don't see any justification for it, especially since I looked at the council rules, and there is It says that they all go by the open meetings law. I will look tomorrow and maybe in 2 weeks we can discuss it, but as far as I'm concerned, it should not change from the way it's been managed as long as I've lived here, where is the public is invited and there's public comment.
Jane, well, there's no public, is it public comment during the, I don't believe there's public comment during an advisory committee.
There's no public, the open meetings law, the open meetings law does not require any public comment except in the places that specifically it says in the law, public comment is required, like things that fall under the public participation goal, okay? Yes. So all public meetings are business meetings for the public body to get their business done. And if the public body also wants to allow the public to comment, they can. The public can be there. They absolutely have a right to be there, but there is nothing in any of the laws that says they have a right to talk.
I agree. I've seen that in print. That is okay. True. But at this point, it's my understanding that they are not invited, and that is the part I'm raising a question about.
And that's correct, and that's because of COVID restrictions. So
that is what?
We're pursuant to, there's no public here because we are amenable to COVID restrictions. We are in a state of emergency, and okay. This governing body has that okay. state of emergency that it's affected, I believe, through June 30th okay. of this year. And so you're operating, even this governing body operates under different rules and regulations adopted by the governing body in compliance with the state's open meetings laws.
Okay.
So this is why the public's not okay. coming in. We are at the highest level we've ever been and consistently have been. And so no, City Hall is closed. We only, and we okay. socially distance to those limited members.
All right, so that helps me understand. And what I would expect then is when the COVID restrictions, when we make progress and the county gets off the extreme level and it comes back, that then the Parks Committee meetings would be open to the public like they had been.
When this governing body okay. withdraws its emergency powers
okay.
and declaration, then the board would be meeting up there and the public could be seated, but it's an advisory committee.
Right. Okay.
So, you know, unless they change how they operate, I don't know whether or not they will be accepting public comment because they're not required to.
They're not required to. They may wish to because if the city is encouraging people to take part and to volunteer and to give input, then that's a good way to encourage it. But I'm glad that I thought maybe with the change from the board to the committee that it was also a change from an open meeting to a closed meeting, and I'm glad that I'm hearing otherwise, so I appreciate that.
Yeah. It's only because of COVID restrictions.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Jane.
Welcome.
All right. Did we decide I need a motion to adjourn, or can I just adjourn?
I think we have public comment, right?
A motion to adjourn is always in order.
I do need to entertain a motion to adjourn.
I move we adjourn.
Yes, I hear it first.
Or y'all second? Just get up and walk out.
Yeah. All
favor of adjourn.
That was
a
record.
Meeting adjourned.
That was a quick one, too.
I knew, Larry.
I think that's a record for speed. We don't have any URA or anything like that this time, right? Good deal. Good night, all.